So ladies and gentlemen, good morning, everybody. Without any further ado, I would like to give floor to Mr. Nicholas Rosellini, UNDP Deputy Regional Director for Asia and the Pacific region and the director of the UNDP Bangkok Regional Hub, who will be chairing this session. Nicholas, over to you.
Okay. Thank you, and once again, welcome to the first plenary session of this segment. The title of this session is MDGs to SDGs, from 18 NEC commitments to the global evaluation agenda. And I think this really builds on a lot of the opening statements that we heard earlier in the morning. And the objective is really to see some of the key opportunities and challenges that the new 2030 agenda for the SDGs presents, and to see how national evaluation capacities can be strengthened to respond to this new agenda. Before introducing the panel, I'd like to just make three quick points. First, the SDGs should serve as a framework for building national evaluation capacities. The Secretary General of the United Nations recently said that implementation of the post-2015 development agenda will require renewed efforts to strengthen public institutions by enhancing their responsiveness and their accountability. He went on to say that evaluation is critical for promoting this accountability and for understanding what we are doing and what we are doing wrong, and that's from the UN. Given the new set of monitoring of the MDGs taught us that monitoring and evaluation systems are an indispensable element of the development agenda, and that strengthening statistical capacity and information systems is vital. According to a report, which I think you can find outside if you're interested, which was done by the UNDP, by the UNSCAP, and by the Asian Development Bank, in Asia and the Pacific, tracking progress on the 169 targets of the 17 goals will be beyond the current capacity of many statistical systems. Data is weak on a number of important subjects, for example, Goal 6 on water and sanitation, Goal 10 on inequality, Goal 16 on peace and justice, and even the best-equipped countries will struggle to provide data on some of the emerging areas of statistics, such as environment management, asset ownership, and entrepreneurship. So better, my second point is that better data will be needed for the SDGs. And my final point is that we do need to seize the opportunity presented by new innovations to strengthen data collection and monitoring and to make it more inclusive, as we heard from the guest speakers in the morning. And we have a good starting point. The SDG consultations were very consultative. 8.5 million people around the world contributed to the My World survey, for example. And there's growing realization that technology and innovation can help keep SDGs inclusive for the poor and most vulnerable. So I will now introduce the speakers in order of speaking. And first, Ms. Caitlin Wiesen, who is the Chief Regional Policy and Program Support for Asia and the Pacific in the UNDP Bangkok Regional Hub, about this transition from MDGs to SDGs, the implications for the evaluation community, and the challenges and the opportunities. Then we'll hear from Ms. Ana Rosa Soares, UNDP Independent Evaluation Office Evaluation Advisor, who will make a presentation about the 18 NEC commitments signed in the last conference in Sao Paulo, and will tell us a little bit about a baseline study on the 18 commitments that was developed for the 43 countries that signed the commitments in Sao Paulo. And then we will hear from Ms. Dorothy Locks, co-chair of EvalSDGs, who will present the global evaluation agenda that will incorporate refined NEC commitments to support the post-2015 global development agenda in the years to come. So we will, and after that, we'll have a Q&A.
People have to feel that change at a very grassroots level, mm-hmm. and they have to own it. The Sustainable Development Goals will help us take into account the populations that are less privileged, that are vulnerable.
Now, as we are transitioning, taking the agenda of sustainable development goals, UNDP has been engaged to have people be part of the development planning, to have people participate, discuss what are the issues that they see as priorities for the development of their communities.
The new agenda seeks to address the new challenges that the world is facing today, such as climate change, environmental degradation.
Cambio climático seguramente no takun totalmente en tiempos mananya para nampichu paramo principalmente hasta un zetrasakun para entonces y tarpuipis ason jepa mantaña tarpuigo te diría eso como un pues agricultor del campo entonces rogaría a todos que piensen no solo que es un país en todo el mundo hay que pensar a los mandatarios hay que decirlo así.
SDGs, with its very broad, ambitious agenda with 17 goals, speaks to a lot of the concerns that lower middle income countries face on sustainable development and sustaining the gains of development. The SDGs require global cooperation. So it is an opportunity, I would say, to start looking into partnership approach to development.
UNDP and others, starting on January the 1st, 2016, will be ready to help governments and others actually put the things in place that will make things happen on the ground.
Thank you, and a very warm welcome to you, and thank you, Nicholas, for setting the stage. And we wanted to start this session with taking a step backwards and hearing from people what their concerns have been for the SDGs and their establishment. We also wanted to situate the discussion of evaluation, hearing from people's voices, and also, if you will, taking a step back. You'll see the SDG goals are in the background, but what we don't always pay attention to is the preamble. And we really wanted to situate the heart and ethos of the SDGs. We've heard that they've been agreed last month by all heads of state. They really are bold, radical, and ambitious. The preamble states, and I'll just highlight a few quotes, "We can be the first generation to succeed in ending poverty, just as we may be the last to have a chance in saving the planet." As we've heard, it's an agenda for action for people, planet, and prosperity, and seeks to strengthen universal peace and larger freedom. Very boldly, the preamble states, "We recognize that eradicating poverty in all its forms and dimensions is the greatest global challenge and an indispensable requirement for sustainable development." The heads of state also pledged that no one will be left behind, and importantly, we will endeavor to reach the furthest behind first. Now that's radical, not waiting for trickle down to happen. And this will be a tremendous challenge also for evaluators and underscores, as Indra Naidu said at the outset, the need for people-centered, informed evaluation for improving people's lives. Quickly, I just wanted to go through some of the big changes between MDGs to SDGs and highlight a few of the challenges and opportunities related to data, participatory monitoring, complexity and policy coherence, and share with you some of the UN and UNDP's approaches and next steps. I think as we, many of us know, the SDGs were the result of an unprecedented level of mobilization, both at the level of people and government. Over 8 million people voted on the future that they wanted, an extraordinary number. Equally, the four top priorities that came out, very interesting, health, education, jobs, and a new one, more responsive government. There were 88 national consultations, 11 thematic dialogues, and an open working group with a broad intergovernmental process arising from and grounded in Rio Plus 20 and the three pillars of sustainable development: economic, environmental, and social. So this participation is key, and building on the momentum, the challenge is taking this people-centered, bottom-up approach to the design into the evaluation. Equally, the SDGs and the 2030 Sustainable Development Agenda is a transformative agenda. It challenges us to transform for people and planet. Critically, it transforms how we understand and strive for prosperity, again, leaving no one behind, aspiring to end poverty in all its forms, and addressing inequality simultaneously. It encourages to transform based on peace, stability, and inclusion. As we've heard, it's a universal agenda, urging action by all countries, developed and developing alike. It addresses risks and strengthens resilience. It urges us to go beyond silos and prioritize action across a broad range of interlinked goals and provide support across government and government ministries. Critically, it focuses on the need for multi-stakeholder partnerships and multi-stakeholder partnerships at all levels. This slide, some of you may be familiar with, the shift from MDGs to SDGs and what is new. And you'll see that in terms of dignity, poverty, and the fight towards inequality, access to health, these resonate very much with the goals that have been set with the MDGs. What are standout differences between them is first in terms of the planet, where there was one goal with the MDGs, there are five dedicated to the intersectorality between the five goals. Equally, there's one dedicated goal to justice, just and peaceful societies, also new. And there are five goals related to prosperity and inclusive growth and what that growth should look like. Another cut here looks at some of the goals, and there are some standalones that have been and dedicated goals that are highly welcome. Gender equality is new. Requests for decent work, reducing inequality, peaceful societies, and again, the five dedicated to planet, related to energy, environment, oceans, climate change. We'll just take a moment and look at some of the lessons learned from MDG implementation. And I think one of the key lessons learned, and we are lucky, fortunate, the MDGs came after the Millennium Declaration had been decided. And the monitoring and evaluation scheme was developed years. It took years for it to be developed. And it has evolved over time. It's highly complex. We have annual ministerial reviews, development cooperation forums. We have an annual progress reporting by the UN Secretary General to the GA. We have thematic reporting every 5 years. We have interagency expert groups, UN statistical divisions, and at the country level, statistical offices around the globe have been engaged. We've had MDG reports, some 500 national MDG reports. There is a huge opportunity for us to build on this. The 2030 Development Agenda, the SDGs, were agreed at the same time as the declaration. We are off to a very fast start. A key point in terms of lessons learned: what gets measured gets done. The MDG framework strengthened use of data for evidence-based decision-making, with many countries integrating MDGs into national priorities. Another key lesson is the importance of multi-stakeholder partnerships with civil society, business, and government at global, regional, and national levels. We also learned that only by counting the uncounted can we reach the unreached or those furthest left behind, underscoring the need for aggregation of data, which masks important disparities and often conveys the wrong impression and picture of progress. The other key learning we had is the need for real-time data to make better decisions faster and influencing policy. We can't wait years and years for that change to happen. Finally, despite improvements, critical data and evidence for policymaking is lacking, as Nicholas highlighted in his opening remarks. And then I think a final point, and as was highlighted by our speakers earlier today, the need to shift from donor-driven to country-driven evaluations. Looking forward to challenges and opportunities, we wanted to highlight a few, and I think one of the key ones moving forward is really the call for a data revolution. The UN high-level panel on the post-2015 development agenda called for a data revolution to improve accountability, decision-making, and meet the challenges of measuring sustainable development progress. Launch of the new Global Partnership for Sustainable Development Data was undertaken in Addis Ababa, well ahead of the agreement on the SDGs themselves. That's a huge marker. And it seeks to harness the data revolution to fill critical gaps and ensure data is more open and usable to end extreme poverty, combat climate change, and ensure a healthy life and leaving no one behind. Finally, the data revolution allows us to tap new technologies, skills, and opportunities to connect official statistics, big data, citizen-generated data, as we've heard, geospatial and Earth observation data for the public good. The opening up of government data to improve policymaking, foster entrepreneurial innovation, and empower citizens is further bolstering the data revolution. Within the SDG, there are two, under the means of implementation, there are two targets dedicated to data. One calls for disaggregated data by income, gender, and other key dimensions. And the second one calls to build on existing initiatives to develop measurements of progress on sustainable development. As we speak, the UN Statistical Commission is convening an interagency expert group on SDG indicators here in Bangkok. Their mandate is to develop an indicator framework for the SDGs. And this framework, the indicator framework, is expected to be finalized by the end of next month, 30th of November, and to be tabled at the 47th session of the Statistical Commission. Just a quick slide on the data revolution and big data. And I think the key thing which has been said by our speakers is the exponential increase that new technologies have brought to the volume and type of data. They are bigger, faster, more detailed than ever. On the opportunity side, a tremendous opportunity to gain better understanding of the changes in human well-being and to get real-time feedback on how policy responses are working and make those changes sooner. However, a note of caution, it is critical that data systems linked to decision making, and that data capacity and resources to analyze data. It doesn't help to have massive data if we also highlight we have global pulse. Promote the awareness of big data. It's also, it has a vision people's engagement in the monitoring, evaluation, and accountability set up. At this, we know that poverty monitoring evaluation is only geared to measuring the effectiveness of a partnership and empowering beneficiaries, as transparency, and taking corrective performance and outcomes. Today, we know we have 90% by cellular network. And this provides an enormous opportunity for real-time feedback. We've also heard of the new tools that exist, the people's report cards, the social accountability tools, and the citizens' report cards. There is a plethora. Together with this, another key issue to be tackled and an implication of the SDGs is addressing complexity and policy coherence. And this is one of my favorite, this one here, contribute to several goals, and it shows their interrelatedness and interconnectedness. It shows the depth with which the SDGs were some of the complex, the 169 targets and 17 goals. It also presents a challenge for some of our policy coherence. And I think importantly, we're going to need to look at pursuing all 17 and 169 targets at the same time will be a challenge. There will be trade-offs, there will be synergies. What tools do we have to analyze those trade-offs to help inform policy making? It's also a dynamic process and requires constant learning and feedback and adaptation strategies. So this is not to discourage you, but to somehow reflect at least some of the complexity at hand. I wanted to highlight a few of what we see as some of the issues or challenges for evaluators in this context. And one is looking at and measuring the big picture. Development is not easy, the targets and outcomes are complex, and we have a challenge to assess the causality between SDGs and policies. Evaluation needs to build on and grow beyond simple models of causality and log frame. Tools are needed, as we said, to assess trade-offs between policy options, and the trade-offs are real. And evaluation needs to provide feedback into the policy and planning and budgetary processes, and we equally need to break down the silos in the process, engaging multi-stakeholder partnerships and taking what we call a whole-of-government approach, not selected ministries, but a whole-of-government approach. Turning to the last slides here, Undersecretary General mentioned earlier this MAPS has been designed by the UN Development Group. UNDP has been intimately involved, and this will form a core of our work moving forward. The three dimensions are mainstreaming, acceleration, and policy support. Key is mainstreaming and integrating SDGs into national and subnational local plans. Acceleration will really be looking at bottleneck analysis and what is needed, what are the steps, the policies needed to overcome those bottlenecks and accelerate action, and the range of policy support and technical assistance that's needed to accomplish this. In all that we do, the three underliers will be partnership development. It can't be done alone. It's a massive agenda, and we stand ready to partner with government, civil society, business sector, and others. Accountability, monitoring, review frameworks are going to be essential, and the sooner they are developed and they are robust, the better. And data, the need for data and evidence to inform policy, critical. Oh, sorry, I did all that without showing you the slide. My apologies. Just wanted to end with one slide, and this is looking at MDG and SDGs at the country level and key steps that will be needed. Right here is a cycle. This was developed with the UNDP and the UNDG group of the planning, doing, checking as a continuous cycle. In terms of what's key for initiating now, I think for this meeting, it's really the monitoring, reporting, and accountability. And I think there's a looking at systems. disaggregating data is going to be key. First, the indicators, and we're hoping to have a set of good indicators by the end of November. Disaggregating the data by sex, age, and other key dimensions that are going to help us reach the people who are most left behind. Reviewing existing strategies and plans, and to compare against existing global SDGs and target and identify gaps at national and subnational levels. Monitoring and reporting systems, working with existing data and metadata systems, creating online systems for exchange of information and reporting on key indicators. And then finally, reviewing process and mechanisms to track progress on national and subnationally adapted and SDGs. So I just wanted to, since many of you are from national reporting groups, to leave this one slide with you. And with that, I'd like to say thank you very much and look forward to the deliberations today.
Thank you, Caitlin. And I think coming from that, I mean, these underlying principles of universality, inclusion, partnership, and I think you really showed that it cannot be business as usual, either for the development community or for evaluation practitioners as we move ahead, transitioning from MDGs to SDGs. But at the same time, there's a lot of positives, and we do need to build on the lessons of the MDGs. So I'll now ask Ana Rosa to talk about the NEC commitments. Thank you.
Hello again. Well, thank you so much. Thank you, Kathleen. This really helped to set the stage for our 3 days of discussions on how to improve national evaluation capacity now in light of the new development challenges of the SDGs. So I will talk a little bit about the NEC journey and how we come to be, how we arrived at 18 commitments and how we are transforming these 18 commitments into the Declaration of Bangkok and into the Global Evaluation Agenda. So the NEC journey started in Morocco in 2009 when we had only about 30 countries engaged. It was mostly government officials participating and the Office of Evaluation of UNDP. In 2011, we had the second NEC conference in South Africa. And there we started to further engage with other partners, not just government, but civil society, UN agencies as well. In Brazil, it was very clear that we would get together for these conferences, but right after the conference, the exchange of knowledge would die. So we developed a strategy in Brazil to make sure that we would discuss every day, during that week how to improve national evaluation capacity, but we would commit as partners, as people, as individuals, and as institutions to continue the discussion and to focus on implementing concrete actions to develop capacity development, capacity evaluation development. So in Brazil, the partners that were there, all the participants, discussed challenges to address, solutions to address the challenge related to national evaluation capacity development. And the 3 days that we were together, we came up with the 18 NEC commitments. And since then, we have been working all throughout 2014 and 2015 to discuss how to push forward these 18 commitments. And this is where we are now in Thailand, and we thought it would be very important to report on what happened after 2013. And it was clear that we were not ready to report on progress, but it was necessary to at least study where we are now. So in a few more years, we can report on the progress itself. And with this, we develop a baseline study that I'll talk a little bit more about later. So a bit more about the journey of NEC. We started in 2009 with 30 countries, 55 participants. In 2011, we had 20 more countries and 80 participants. In Brazil, 63 countries and 160 participants. And today we have here 100 countries represented and over 430 participants. So the baseline study was covering the 43 UNDP countries. We had 60 countries in Brazil in 2013, but 43 countries were developing countries where UNDP works. So we focused on these countries because it's where we had data availability and more urgency to explore what kind of information we had available. So these are some of the 43 countries we had. So the 18 commitments, the participants developed and signed these 18 commitments in 2003, focusing on enhancing national evaluation capacities, but specifically encouraging accountability by calling upon the countries and the NEC participants to commit to actions in a collaborative way, especially in the South-South cooperation mode. So this baseline study documents now the current state of national evaluation capacities and the existing institutional setups in these 43 UNDP program countries. We have documented information mostly based on website information or a survey that we conducted and exchanges with, especially with the participants from the different three conferences. And we try to collect information on these three key areas, which were the key areas discussed in 2003. independence, credibility, and use of evaluation. And each of the 18 commitments, they were very much aligned with one or two, and most of the time with all three of these areas of evaluation. So the commitments went from very simple ideas of exchanging publications, translating publications, to something much more complex, such as developing capacity for integrating data systems, data registries for better use of that information for evaluation. We had other commitments that were more specific, such as how to introduce or further engage gender analysis in evaluation, making evaluation more gender responsive. Also thinking about budgetary constraints. How can we go around budgetary constraints and still have credible ways of producing evaluation? So I won't go in further in very detail in each of these commitments, but you will have seen in every publication that we've produced, and I will try to summarize what we have in terms of key findings on this baseline assessment, not per country, but just the general. So this study was conceived as a descriptive factual document as opposed to an evaluative assessment. So we're not judging countries. We're basically just collecting the information we found around the countries on those 18 commitments and putting it together in a publication. Of course, we were not able to find information for every country on each of the 18 commitments, but as much as possible, we wanted to list there, even if they were empty, so we can continue to advance on a baseline and hopefully soon on a progress assessment. So the other constraint of this baseline assessment was language, of course. It was very challenging to find information on only four languages, which were the languages of the team that were working on this: Portuguese, Spanish, French, and English. But we were able to find a good number of data to share with you. So some of the commitments were not country-oriented only. Some of the commitments were global commitments, or they were UN or UNDP-specific commitments. So for example, commitment 1 and 12 were about simply promoting knowledge sharing among countries and developing a structure or a framework that would allow us to keep track of what was happening in each country and how we were exchanging knowledge. So we developed a community of practice, UNDP developed a community of practice with the International Policy Center for Inclusive Growth, and we started to map information that would be exchanged between the participants. So this is a website on UN Teamworks that is open to everybody, and you can see the discussions that happen, and you can add to those discussions. But we're still very far from having a concrete monitoring and evaluation framework for progress on national evaluation capacities. So as we were discussing in the community of practice, we even started thinking, it's interesting to have a baseline assessment or a baseline study, but we still need a MNE framework for national evaluation capacity. So perhaps now we'll publish a book based on the baseline study, but what we really need is perhaps a website where people will be able, different nations will be able to upload their information, and we would know who does what, where, and how we can exchange with the different countries to learn and to improve. So section, like commitment 13, the same, you know, it was basically one of those commitments that were, we commit to exchange information, therefore we need to translate a lot of this information. There's quite a lot of information in English, but not in many of the other languages. So there was a really interesting task force led by EvalPartners and multiple volunteers around the globe to translate a number of documents on evaluation for public use, and started simply with the logo of the Eval year. It was really interesting what a movement we were able to put together with EvalPartners leading this effort, just to simply start translating a logo that was a movement. And from there, other documents has got published as well. Also, we started keeping track of all the multiple events that we were getting together to continue to discuss what we started in Brazil in 2013. So today, we have over 100 events that happened around the globe. And in 2015, we passed the evaluation torch to represent this commitment in this global partnership for evaluation. So more concretely about some of the most complex commitments. National institutional setups. You know, the study revealed a variety of institutional settings and legal frameworks among the countries analyzed. They were reflecting a variety of government interests, political contexts, and national development stages. There are many variations of legal frameworks. Some countries have specific national evaluation policies, others simply some sort of a more informal or formal system, M&E system, but they vary a lot. Some national governments have developed sophisticated structures and policies incorporating mechanisms to ensure that evaluation processes are both credible and independent, but still communicated in a way that makes it useful. Such structures also aim to ensure that evaluation results are useful and used for decision making. Therefore, they need to be timely presented when needed. And that is still still very much a challenge. There's focus on developing methodologies, but not as much on strategies on really communicating and using, making sure we use this information. So in terms of use of evaluation. In general, evaluations are used widely. Different qualities, different means, but they are used widely in these 43 countries that we studied. Many countries do not have a policy, many countries do not have the perfect structure, but they still find a way of using evaluation. Almost all countries are making efforts to promote the use of evaluation either by decision makers, parliamentarians, or VOPs, the voluntary organizations of professional evaluations, or universities or international donors promoting any stakeholders from government to civil society and the most vulnerable as well. I'm going to have to jump or we won't have much time. Okay, so in promoting and supporting independence of evaluation, some countries have developed systems to promote follow-up of evaluations. This was a very important commitment that generated a lot of discussions during the conference and after the conference as well. So we've been discussing how countries were able to put together some sort of management response tracking systems or citizens' commissions that would be able to track the responses or the implementation of recommendations. In terms of standards to ensure stakeholder involvement while still guaranteeing independence, some countries called for participation of civil society and started to train numerous people to understand evaluation, but to allow this engagement in a more participatory but still independent format. Okay, I see I have little time. In terms of credible use of methodologies as well, this was one of the key focus of this, at least this last 2 years that we worked together as a partnership. So in conclusion, it is important to understand that the fabric out of which countries and national governments are made of is not uniform. There are 18 commitments that we all agree to, but each country and each partner focused on different strategies. And it will be the same with the SDGs. So the focus of each country leading the strategy that is best appropriate is what the 18 commitments became. These granular aspects of national evaluation capacities are complex and intrinsically linked to each country's development agenda, so therefore need to be taken into consideration and incorporated into the development of future evaluation agendas. So in conclusion, when we developed the survey to fill in gaps on the baseline study, we added one question that wasn't about what is it that your country is doing or where can I find information about this in your country, but it was specifically and very personal. What would be the key priorities to build national evaluation capacities in your country that we should discuss in this NEC conference in 2015, and that we should make sure it is incorporated in a NEC Bangkok declaration and should be incorporated in the global evaluation agenda? So the results we got from this survey, which was with the 43 countries, but also an additional global effort that sent over to thousands of partners, eval partners and NEC partners, this is the results we came up with for the moment. And I thought it was important to bring to the conference so you can continue this consultation. So throughout the 3 days, every session should also raise the question, what would be the key priorities for your countries or for your region or globally that we should focus on? And that is what will be represented in the declaration and in the global evaluation agenda. So for the moment, what came up first were strengthen credible national data systems to monitor performance of policies and programs, develop clear national level mechanisms for independent evaluation to track, monitor, and evaluate the progress of the SDGs, assign resources percentage of the initiative's cost for the conduct of evaluation when designing and approving projects, programs, and policies, formally build the capacity of evaluators to improve the quality of evaluations, and develop systems to promote transparent follow-up of evaluation recommendations. So this is part of the input we would like to leave with you for your discussions in the next 3 days. Of course, this is the result of the survey. It doesn't have to be the final information that will go into the declaration, especially because the declaration is not, let me see if we have that. So the declaration does not construct to be an intergovernmental agreement. It is an expression of aspirations and not a legally binding on any individual or government. But it is an extension of our commitment that we put together in 2013. It is much more focused on values and principles that we all agree on than specific commitments or concrete actions that will need to be taken by all of us. Not. But it's more on the principles. And from there, we hope that you will go back to your countries and decide on a concrete agenda to implement your key priorities. So from the Bangkok Declaration that we hope to present to you on Friday, based on your contributions in each of the panels until Friday, we will hand the information to the colleagues from EvalPartners and the government of Nepal to ensure that our voice is also communicated in the final document of this year that will be the Global Evaluation Agenda. Thank you.
So thank you very much, Anna Rosa. It was very helpful to have very clear marching orders for what we expect to get out of this conference in terms of commitments. But it was also very interesting to see the amount of work that goes on in between these conferences. These are not one-off events. There's a community of practice, and there's a lot of work in terms of implementing these commitments that's been happening since the last meeting in Brazil. So thank you. Now I'll ask Dorothy to talk about the global evaluation agenda. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody, for inviting Eval Partners to give some information on the global evaluation agenda. If Anna is giving you your marching orders, then part of my role at the moment is to say, what should those marching orders be? And to ask you to actually contribute, each one of you, to that process. We've talked about the Eval Year and the Eval Torch, and that has lit a flame around the world. But what we're actually looking for is that universality that we've been talking about in the SDGs. So the year of evaluation, 2015, we've heard this morning how 2015 is a bit of a magic year. So what happens? Of course not. That's when the work really starts. Each one of you who is attending this conference is bringing knowledge and skill. You're bringing the voices. You're bringing knowledge of the experiences of people in your own countries. And I'm going to talk to you a little about 30, because that's a long way down. I hope I'll be sitting. As a community of practitioners, is it within your sphere of influence, sphere of knowledge and experience? To the longer agenda of 2030. Being the process which NEC has been instrumental in having the Eval Year declared. In terms of focusing on capacity building, so it means that we are building something together. It means that we are not just declaring things, we're actually commitments that you've been making have been spreading around the world. So the global evaluation agenda is looking at actions that will spread around the world. We've talked about the importance of data. From data visualizing, but make sure in that of the people is actually heard. So what are the key priorities that are emerging from the consultation process that Anna has talked to you about? We know that right across the world, the events for Eval Year, they have been collated, you have been at those other events in your own countries. Rest assured that those are being fed into the global agenda process. So I've just pulled out from this process which is pertinent to this group here. What does that mean? The enabling environment means that we can help to create a better support for evaluation, for active evaluations, for use of the findings of evaluation. That requires the commitments of national government. And what does coming out of the survey is that there has to be commitment in terms of looking what works best in policy development. Environment that aspect is looked at. About resources for evaluation, that's often the elephant to talk to the people and to find out what is really working. Evaluators are mobilizing more and more through what we call VOPES, which is a bit of a mouthful, but what it's a voluntary association of professional evaluators who are contributing. Charge to actually work with governments. Sharing objectives and moving forward on a common agenda. Not be bewildered. It's actually helps. As an evaluator for many of a lonely planet out there. But as you can see that there are different planets circulating, but there is a clear orbit. Have slightly different, even if we focus on our firmament, which is the SDGs, and I think a number of you followed the light, the thing that will light our way through the global evaluation agenda, the SDGs will be very important for showing a direction instead of evaluation or governance in a very sort of global term, but without that specificity. With the SDGs, it really helps to give us a focus and something to work on in terms of our data generation, our systems, our improvement, and eventually better lives for every single one of our people, particularly those who are marginalized. You've already heard an agenda will be launched in Nepal in November at the culmination of Eval Year. I'm not going to explain a great deal of the detail of what's in the global evaluation agenda, because otherwise it would be like the example that Malika used and saying that everything was decided ahead of time. It hasn't been. We are actively holding meetings every day, I think, on how all these aspects can be included in the global evaluation agenda. But one thing is clear, that we do need to work on four different levels. One is at that global enabling environment policy development, but we also the strengthening of capacity in terms of people, systems, analysis. We need to look at individual evaluator looking at in the last few days, and really some of those critical questions of how evaluators operate in the current environment and contribution of every evaluator make sure that we move that agenda forward. And then how do those things mutually reinforce? So partnerships, we've heard, are really important, but also adding value to what is coming out of evaluations and making sure that we really use those findings and commit to making sure that change occurs as a result of. What's your responsibility, each of you sitting here? Because we're not going to do all the work, it's a combined effort, isn't it? So we want each one of you through this conference to actually the Bangkok Declaration, as explained by Anna. Declaration, but the details that are coming each and every session. So there will be note takers that you will see who are recording what is going on. And we've been having a discussion over the last few days about the need for having a book. Sure that the richness of what comes out of this consultation is that synthesis that will help to give us. Just a mention of another element that has been emerging out of the process. In our universe. Forged as these networks are developed. SDGs, the parliamentarian network, I'm sure that a number of you will already be involved in that, and that's strengthening and growing. Eval Gender Plus, talking about emerging evaluators, those in the field, how can we best strengthen their indigenous? This is an important aspect when talking about professionalization of evaluators. How do indigenous people who have their own cultures and practices, how are they brought into the whole process of capacity development? So as you move through your sessions in the conference, you will be asked some questions, and we hope that you will take these with you and think, lose sleep, why not? Conferences are to don't let those thoughts be lost as you go through this conference. So what would be, as you think through your sessions, what would Declaration, and let Anna know what that thought is. What are the three priorities from NEC that need to be considered in the process of moving forward with the implementation of the SDG? And what is the most important aspect for collaboration? Because if we're working to collide, we want to actually work in harmony. So what is the best way for collaboration? Is it networks, or are we missing something? So now is a really good opportunity to bring those aspects out. So we thank you for being part of the process and hope that that flame will become a bigger sun as we move forward in implementation of the SDGs and evaluating and making sure that that brings changes in people's lives. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I think I learned a new acronym today, which is, what is it, VOPE or VOPE? VOPE. That's a new one on me, but I'll remember it now. Thank you. But more importantly, I think, again, we got some very clear guidance on what the expectations, what the outcomes of this meeting should be, and how it fits into the broader challenge of developing a global evaluation agenda for the SDG era. And I particularly like the reference again, as we heard in the opening, to excluded groups, because I think this is very important given the principles of the SDGs, that this is a special focus of this meeting and the discussions. So thank you for that. We now have about 30 minutes, is that correct, anyone? About 30 minutes for Q&A. So we can start. Can each person who wants to say something, please keep it brief so we can hear from as many people as possible, and introduce yourself, please.
Hi, I'm Craig Russum from the ILO. Dr. Lux, when you were explaining the global agenda, you tended to use the royal we quite often, but I'm not quite sure whose global evaluation agenda this is. Is it the UN global evaluation agenda? Is it the IDEAS global evaluation agenda? Is it the NEC? Is it who is taking ownership of this?
I think we'll take a few at a time. Then we can hear from more people. But that's a very direct first question. Thank you. Yes, over there, please. There are mics around.
Thank you. I'm Emmanuel David from Benin. And I have a direct question to, is it Anna Maria? Excuse me, I'm watching your name.
Anna Rosa.
Anna Rosa. I heard a lot about that baseline study, and things have been happening in Benin. We have an NEP, National Evaluation Policy. In Benin was quoted. We've been also working on capacity buildings, parliamentary level, and also at the level of local government. And is like over 3 local governments, which is some kind of new way of bringing evaluation and norm at the level. Whatever it is, so that it can be known.
Thank you. We'll take one or two more, and then we'll pass back to the panel.
Here, one.
Yes, over there. Two over there, and then we'll stop for responses.
Matthew Burgess from UNICEF Evaluation Office in New York. My question is to Anna Rosa. Thank you for the excellent presentation on the National Evaluation Capacity Building. I think one area that we should also continue to focus is that countries are no longer taking projects in aid. So evaluation capacity should focus on the normative and the quality of policies and the implementation of those policies, as well as on the budgeting and aspects. So that capacity has to be within the governments and how that is done as a national agenda. So evaluation, and we have done very little on the quality of policy advice and the quality of policies that countries does for the evaluation to have an impact. Thank you.
Thank you. And there was one more on that side, I think.
Thank you, Aru Rasapan from the Asia Pacific Evaluation Association. Just two comments on the acronym WOPACE. Just a small correction. It's not a voluntary organization of professional evaluators. It's a voluntary organization for professionalization of evaluation. Oh. It makes a big difference.
Yeah.
The comment I had is taking off on what Craig had mentioned about what is the real focus of the national evaluation agendas we are talking about. I think in all the discussions, I find something missing. It's about how do we actually institutionalize evaluation within countries, within organizations, so that we can improve performance to improve whatever we're doing. I think that's the whole crux of the thing. It's not about professionalizing evaluation. It's not about that. It's not about an external demand on evaluation for the sake of evaluation or for the sake of accountability. The issue should be, how do we empower institutionalized evaluation and empower organizations to improve the entire process of public management so that we can produce better results at the organizational level, program level, national level, and so on and so forth. So I wonder if the panel can give some comments on that, please. Thank you
okay,
very much.
Thank you. So we'll take more questions, don't worry. But I think we have had four sets of questions now. So we'll come back to the panel for some initial responses. I think starting with the first question, Dorothy, and also I think you need to answer some of the others. So we'll start with you.
Yeah, thank you very much. It's definitely not the royal we. The we has been very large. So I think throughout the whole process, you've heard of how so many organizations have been getting involved in these discussions. So through conferences, through a whole range of different voices, and this being one of them. Who's generating the global evaluation agenda? At the moment, that's being held with EvalPartners, because that is a link between the organizations of evaluators around the world through the International Organization for Cooperation and Evaluation, and UN agencies and think tanks and institutions, and it's a growing group of EvalPartners, which you can go onto the website and look at the moment, how many people are there, and if anybody else wants to join, please join us.
While
in terms of broadening the we on the professionalization aspect, what I was the organizations themselves of the voluntary organizations of evaluators. So there may be abbreviation is being used more, which is fine, a lot. In terms of building capacity within governments, within public administration, absolutely. That is happening worldwide, and as it should be, that it's the systems and the systems for evaluation need to be strengthened, and I think that's come through in the work that Anna's done.
Thank you.
Well, thank you, Dorothy, and thank you all for the questions. You know, starting with just complimenting what Dorothy is saying about the we working on this global evaluation agenda, this then you know different declarations and of commitment. It used to be a very small we. It used to be first just IEO of UNDP and a few governments. To make it clear that there's no space, will not move along, government will not move along, EvalPartners will be weak, NEC and NEC will do nothing without EvalPartners. So, but it's still a big challenge in communicating. And above all, it's not just who wants to be involved and who wants to be committed. In the end of the day, it's again not just training people to be great evaluators, but you need to be a good evaluator and understand what will make better policies and better governments and better civil society for changing people's lives. So it's not sufficient to train evaluators in methods. They're important. NEC really focuses not just bringing really governments and civil society, commissioners, and people that commission evaluation, or simply just manage evaluation, because they understand about policy better than we evaluators understand about policy. So it's a community, but there's still a lot of work to be done. We will have a very interesting joint panel to discuss how to move forward on this. And I would challenge, you know, challenge this panel to really add
discussion, not just how we accreditize evaluators, but how do we make sure better policies? How do we, from
evaluators? And I think on that last point about policy, how to make better policy, how to evaluate the effectiveness, come in.
Thank you. Thank you, Nicholas, and thank you. Within UNDP, so there's often the system is not existing to incorporate. So you really need to be looking at performance, looking at results-based performance and how to integrate that into is very slow. It moves very, takes some time for indicators. So looking at what some of the interim indicators, real-time monitoring has through innovation, a possibility to actually turn this quite on its head. We do center located in Singapore. We have a team that is grappling with these kinds of issues. Thank you.
Thank you. But we'll continue with the questions now. There was one over there. Yes, please, in the front row. There's a mic coming.
Thank you very much. I can speak English, but I try to speak French. Il Mansouri Hassan de l'Observatoire National. Désolé.
I think we need one more of this. The one speaks French.
I can. Il Mansouri, il Hassan, l'Observatoire de développement humain, Maroc. D'abord, je remercie que ça va nous demander un peu des idées, mais uniquement à chaud, moi je vais rejoindre le point de vue de mon collègue de Bénin, et parmi les premiers pays et co-organisateurs de cette manifestation. Beaucoup d'efforts, beaucoup d'innovations, et je ne vous cache pas, et la question est adressée à notre amie Anna Rosa, j'ai reçu un questionnaire qui consiste à demander à l'ensemble d'un certain nombre de pays leur expérience, l'évolution, les boîtes à outils qu'on a développées, retour sur expérience, etc. Et je vous avoue que durant l'expérience, je suis resté un peu, peut-être que j'ai l'impression que le Maroc n'a pas fait suffisamment d'efforts pour faire connaître ce qu'il a fait comme travail en termes de aujourd'hui pour éventuellement cette expérience au niveau du Maroc, et pas seulement, il y a plusieurs pays, notre modeste expérience dans la région. Et merci.
OK, thank you. There was one here in the middle, yes, please, and then one on the left.
Thank you so much. I'm Zulfikar Durrani, and currently I'm the Secretary of Planning and Development Department, Government of Balochistan, Pakistan. First of all, thank you so much for these enlightening presentations. Evaluations, monitoring and evaluations, that is something that all national governments are responsible. We take it as our state duty. We should be doing all that. Definitely, but we would require the United Nations Agency's support in this. But having seen the experience of the MDGs, if I may go back to Pakistan and if see the not so many successes, and then we are moving on to a very ambitious SDGs, ambitious plan. We also experience this delivering as one. We came up with OP1 and OP2, and we are in the middle of OP2, and I think still we are nowhere. So having all these experiences, when countries in South Asia, Southeast Asia, and developing countries in Africa are looking towards the experts to strengthen their monitoring, then we, at the same time, we see the UN. So don't you think it's the national governments? Because the national government recognize their weaknesses. They recognize the importance of the evaluation. But when we talk about support, then we have a silos approach. So this is something that maybe at the end, by the end of the conference, this is so much.
Thank you. Please.
Thank you so much, Anton, for these nice presentations. I'm Serge Eric Yaku, the former president of the African Evaluation Associations. I'm also working as a senior evaluator and a visiting professor. I think to avoid a big gap, there are two main issues I don't think we mentioned it within the SDG. The first one is how are we going to align the target within national policy? Because as Malika mentioned into her keynote speech, the big challenge is how to fit and meet the benefit of people. The second challenge is to how to fit into national budget. And then my question is, to what extent do you think we should be able to get this done? Thanks so much.
Thank you. Very concise. And then there was one here, I think. Over here in the middle. And then there's, and then we can, yes, and then we'll come to you. Yeah.
Thank you very much. My name is Engineer Amir Zamir Ahmad Khan. I am Director General Monitoring and Evaluation and Planning Commission, Islamabad, Pakistan. My question is, for last 2 years, Pakistan is doing well in economy side. Our growth rate is over 4%. Our foreign reserves are crossing the $20 billion. Our economic indicators are on positive side, but these indicators are not translating into the MDGs. In MDGs, we are far behind our targets. So with the help of UNDP, we are doing that, but this is not translating into the MDGs. We have not achieved the targets of MDGs, and we have now got other challenges of SDGs. So what is the reason of this? Thank you very much.
Well, that's probably needs a seminar in its own right, but interesting question, thank you. Yes, and then the lady at the back there.
My name is Rana Hamza. I'm a senior advisor in the Ministry of International Cooperation in Egypt. My question to Ms. Anna Rosa, when you were talking about widening the base of information sharing and data sharing, you mentioned a mechanism about creating a website or a database where votes or governments and individuals can upload their information. Do you consider a mechanism for data validation for the information that can be shared within such a website or a database? Thank you.
Thank you. And then the gentleman here.
Yes, I'm Ricardo Palastro. I'm from the regional office of UNICEF for East Asia and the Pacific. I would like to ask you, you've outlined some of the challenges of the MDGs. I want to understand a little bit, to what extent are we overcoming these? And the MDGs obviously brought evidence to the table, very important, but there were some systemic gaps that were pointed out. when we were looking at the monitoring and the evaluation. Now, to what extent are we bridging those gaps as now we're increasing the complexity of the spectrum and stars are not supposed to collide?
Okay, thank you. One more, yes, gentleman there. And then here, yeah. And I think that'll be the final one in this round. So this over there and then on the left.
Ghulam Mustafa, Deputy Chief, Planning Committee, female dominant session. And very good presentations. And maybe a question. Actually, IP debt has played a great role in the introduction of evaluation methods, and it was there at IPDET that I came to know what is theory of change. Many people don't know even what is theory of change. And if somebody does not know what is theory of change, and he calls himself evaluator, that is, I think, very interesting. So, I know in conferences like this, we need commissioners as well as evaluators. And there is a mix. So, we should take the message of the conference to our governments, and we should try to develop the MNE systems. In monitoring, more people are interested, but less in evaluation, and we need to train more and more people in evaluation. Thank you so much.
Thank you, and I can assure the audience that this is just a coincidence that there were three speakers from Pakistan and three gentlemen. Yes, please.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for the very educated presentations. I'm Kezong from Bhutan. I have two comments or questions to all the panels, actually. I want to follow up on the comment by the gentleman from Pakistan on the theory of change. And from the workshop yesterday, I also learned that there is a theory of no change. From the presentations and from the workshops as well, I realized that evaluation is being actually treated as a piece in the whole discussion. And I think it will be important to really go beyond that in terms of looking at the whole project program management cycles that you look at for people to understand the real necessity of evaluating programs and projects that will change people's lives. So this is my first comment. The second one is with regard to awareness and advocacy on SDGs. I know UN is doing a lot of things on this already, I think we should be aware that I think more than 80% of the world didn't know about MDGs. I'm talking about people at the grassroots. So I think it will be important really to generate that awareness at the grassroots level so that they can demand or they are aware of what we are doing in terms of trying to achieve those goals to make to change people's lives. In that regard, while I think Dorothy mentioned about mainstreaming SDGs at the country level, I would also like to suggest emphasizing mainstreaming SDGs at the community level. I hope that will be one of the recommendations going on the global evaluation agenda, because that's something that country, especially developing countries like Bhutan, will require your help in terms of really making difference in the lives of people at the grassroots. And hopefully making this two-way street. I think we have talked a lot. It has generally been one way. I think we are getting there. Hopefully it will be a two-way street. Thank you.
Thank you, and we've run out of time for questions. In fact, I took a lot of the panelists' time by having more questions. I thought it would be good to hear from all the participants. Some of the issues around the UN itself, the panel's welcome to address that, but I mean, there is a whole discussion about fit for purpose about the UN, how we can break down some of these silos, and Caitlin may want to talk a little bit more about the maps as part of the response. And certainly on UNDP part, we've undertaken with the IEO that we will make a big effort in Asia and the Pacific, at least, to disseminate the results and inform our officers of everything that happens in this meeting. So we will start on the left with Caitlin, and then Dorothy, and then Ana Rosa.
Okay. Thank you very much for all those sets of questions. Very important and very relevant. I think starting with where Nicholas mentioned, and I think the question was, you know, that when you ask for support, you get a siloed response. And really the attempt and effort this time around is what was shared earlier, what's called the MAPS, the mainstreaming analysis and policy support, which has been designed together from the UN system family, the whole UNDG. Then within that family, of course, there will be certain agencies that have a certain sectoral expertise, whether that's in health or whether that's in forestry. But the idea is to bring together the best sets of tools that are available through this and to make them available to our national colleagues and partners in this process. In terms of, there was a question about where to start, and I think this was sort of a triple question from Pakistan. How to align SDGs to national projects, and how do they, that was a different question, sorry, but how to fit in national projects. And just to say that I think some of the experience, and I'm speak here from the region, the Asia-Pacific region where I work, but one of the great opportunities is either at the midterm evaluation of national plans or at the end of national plans and the start of new ones. And we've had great success with bringing in some of the thinking of the SDGs and what that means in terms of accountabilities. The other is, how do you bring these down into national projects themselves? And I think that's where there is a challenge. And I think there were questions raised about the theory of change. I don't hope it's not heresy. Theory of change is very important. I think it's overly mystified. I think there's been a lot of root cause analysis that's been involved in project and program appraisal. I think theory of change is just bringing it out to give it more attention. But I do think that calls for, it's very hard as evaluators to come in and try to evaluate a program or project that has not addressed root causes and analysis and theory of change. So that I think the point was raised by the colleague from Bhutan, the need to start and situate evaluation within the whole cycle, and that one needs to get the design principles right to be able to monitor and evaluate effectively at the end. Thank you.
Thank you. Dorothy.
Thank you very much. Very interesting and pertinent questions. And being an evaluator, of course, I've organized them onto a temporal scale. So taking the questions that related from the MDGs to the SDGs, so the challenges in terms of the progress in relation to the MDGs. There's a great video clip that says, why stop halfway, I think it's called. It's very clear that not all the progress achieved, not all of the goals were achieved, but there was great progress. So the race is half run. So this is the next stage of the race. Now, when you're training for a race, you use tools and techniques to improve your fitness. So the question about are those aspects of what was unfit, are those being looked at? Absolutely. And we have so many new tools now that can actually be used to accelerate us through the MAPS process. So the theory of change is really important, but there's other tools and things that are really coming forward. And keeping abreast of some of those developments will be something that the evaluation community has to really engage in. So then moving from, okay, now we're into the SDGs, and how does that get absorbed into the planning process, is Sergei's point about how does that happen. I'm going to push that one back onto you because that's your job. At the national level, you have already national planning cycles. It's up to the job of government officials and parliamentarians to actually raise their voice about the need to engage with evaluation in those cycles. Once you have that dialogue, very often budget items tend to flow. Just a little highlight on Philippines. They're going through this process at the moment, and they're having pain over it. They're really struggling, but they're committed to embedding the SDGs in their national planning process and looking at how that links into their national budget. So have a chat to them and learn from what they're doing. Then going to, well, once you've got the resources, what little things can you do? Our colleague from Morocco and also Kazang from Bhutan, how do you do that? Open source data is something that's being talked about a lot. What about open source evaluations? How many evaluations get put under the table because they have unpalatable findings? But actually, we learn from failures. So when governments are more open and transparent and who actually bring their evaluations into the public sphere and say, look, okay, so maybe we didn't do so well on that, but let's do better next time. That helps the discussion within the country, and Kazang's point about taking it back down to the people by just even a little budget to make the findings of evaluation public and bringing that back down to the people who are involved in the evaluation. We don't do that enough, and that can help to drive the conversation and improvement of our program and project cycles. Did I cover everybody?
Try to cover the rest too.
Okay, thank you. My apologies for not answering Benin, but I want to put together Benin, Morocco, and Egypt's question. How do we make your valuable experience available to the rest of the world? You know, it's really a challenge, and of course, NEC is about that. It's about exchanging, it's about best practice sharing, but it's not sufficient. It's definitely not sufficient, and it's something we definitely need to talk about it in this conference as we move forward. One way we did, I started thinking about, was as I was developing the baseline study, I realized, oh my God, this is not even a baseline study. Maybe then we started calling it towards a baseline study, because we really couldn't validate the information. We could collect information in from websites, from surveys, we could talk to people, but it would still need validation. And that's why we said it's just a factual, descriptive document. It's not an assessment, it's not evaluative at all, because we could not validate the information there. So when I worked, you know, about 10 years ago, I was working with MDGs in Brazil, and the UNDP launched a website that was called MDG Monitor. And it was basically a website where governments would upload their information. They were not validated. You had to trust governments that were putting the right information there. But it's got its weaknesses, I understand, but it is better than having nothing. So it was really interesting as we were putting together the panels, because working with my UNDP colleagues at the different regional bureaus, they themselves are pretty busy. They didn't know what each of your countries did best or were in need of in terms of national evaluation capacity. So those 43 countries, no matter how weak that study is so far today, it was still very helpful to many. So it's a starting point, and I would leave the suggestion of having a website with my colleagues from the from headquarters. They are going to launch a national evaluation capacity global project for them to consider perhaps having a website, and perhaps we, the Independent Evaluation Office, and many other colleagues here
could have a commitment of every year trying to validate some of the information that is there. So what we have now, it's not sufficient. It's just a small seed, but it's something that we can think together, especially to share best practices. We have many books, many conferences, but it's still not sufficient. But we have a lot of valuable information out there. So to go back to Serge and perhaps our colleague here from UNICEF, I think your questions are very important, and I would like you to ask them again on Friday. Because I think a lot of this information we need to discuss and digest. Let's see how far we get until Friday. On the silos, you know, our colleagues from Pakistan with very interesting comments. My job as an evaluator for the Independent Evaluation Office is actually to evaluate UNDP. That's our bread and butter. This is my day job. And of course, it is very challenging, but this organization takes it very seriously. So we as colleagues are here in the same panel. We fight a lot. A lot of times we are in opposite sides because our role is to try to bring to them some of the weaknesses, highlight some of the weaknesses, and make suggestions on how to improve, and for them to take those suggestions and really take it further. Many times change and improve those solutions, those suggestions, and then implement them. So yes, there are many weaknesses in UNDP and in the UN, but there's a very serious effort on the part of the organizations in taking it seriously, the job of us evaluators, even internal or external independent evaluators, on what UNDP can do better and what UN can do better. But again, we are part of this capacity building effort. We, UN, we have a lot to learn and a lot more to progress. So we definitely are in the same side. On the theory of change, you know, I would like to add that the theory of change is not just important for evaluators, but they're extremely important at the planning and the monitoring part of this work. And it's very important. By now, our efforts is actually trying to make the implementers, the policy designs, the project designs, to also think about change, and that's the whole wave of results-based monitoring. And results-based monitoring, unless you're able to think about change, your results are not going to be sufficient. And how do you miraculously jump from input, output to outcome and to change? So theory of change may be just a buzzword, but it's something that it's not just for evaluation, it's for planning and from implementation and monitoring as well. I know we have talked a lot, and we're probably very hungry, but this is a wonderful beginning of a conversation that we continue to have for the next 3 days and be very bold and asking and voicing that, but then coming back and with commitments, with recommendations that we all commit to moving forward and learning together.
Okay, thank you. We've heard now from the panelists, and I think they've done their best to answer the questions, but of course we do have the next 3 days to get into more depth on some of the issues raised. I think the thing here is that this year has seen the building blocks of a major new development agenda for the next 15 years, not just the SDG summit, but also the FFD meeting in Addis Ababa, the COP21 happening in Paris. It'll set the development stage for the next 15, 20 years. and I think evaluation has to both inform that framework for development and also adapt to be suitable for that framework. So it's a major challenge for evaluators. I think we've heard from the panelists on how we can respond to that. And I think I'd also like to thank the participants for some very tough questions, some very good questions. So please join me in applauding the panel for their answers and their presentations.